What is the impact of awareness in my day-to-day life? Why is it important to be aware?
Awareness is believed to be the most primordial intelligence that humankind has been gifted with. In our day-to-day lives, the nature of engagement that we have with the mundane life predominantly needs us to bring in the rational intelligence, which is the intelligence of thoughts, of memories, of meanings, of interpretations, of logic, of definitions, and emotional intelligence, which is the intelligence of emotions, feelings, sensing, and anything to do with emotions. Now, both these kinds of intelligences, that's the rational and the emotional intelligence, draw upon from the memory which is stored from the experiences of the past. It's like there is an archive of films where snapshots of events and experiences of the past are stored, and when we go through a certain experience or a situation or an event, there is a reference to one or more of such films which are stored in the archive of the past, looking for a similar pattern as of the experience of the situation of now. And that is brought up for us to make decisions, to react, and so on and so forth. So much so that when we are in the process of planning or looking at possibilities of the future, the data that we have is from the past. So what we call as future is nothing but an extrapolation of the past. If you notice, all that is there of the past stored in the archive is memories of that which is dead, memories of that which is frozen, memories of that which is static. Awareness is the only intelligence that deals with the data of the present. It has nothing to do with the past that is dead or the future that is still born. In the state of awareness, an individual gets to know and perceive a situation or an event or an individual, including himself or herself, in its entirety, because only in the present are we present. Only in the present are we present, taking data from any other domain of time or space is the data of our absence. So once we are in the space of awareness, A, we are present, B, we are operating at a level of intelligence which has the understanding of the entirety, and C, which is most important, is that we, when we are in a state of awareness, and this is something one has to experience, there is a certain stillness that allows us to respond. Response only happens when we are aware. Everything else is a reaction. It's not even an action, it is a reaction. There is no original thought. There is no original word. There is no original action. If you notice, all that you think, say, or do is a reaction to a stimuli. However, in the state of awareness, an individual can respond, as in the action originates from the being, and that particular action is in complete harmony with the shared awareness of existence outside of the individual. And that is why, for any individual to be able to respond with spontaneity, with appropriateness, with wisdom, and most importantly, with consciousness, the only way it can happen is to be aware. I think I have answered the question cognitively, but then awareness is beyond the world of cognitive understanding. Only experiencing awareness can help one know how is it significant for any individual in day-to-day existence.
Normally, man is asleep and is dreaming in the sleep of being awake. Whatever he sees, he listens, he thinks, and he speaks. Is his imagination, is a part of the dream that he finds himself in and believes to be the reality. His original senses, the sense of sight, sense of hearing, sense of touch and feeling, all of them are numb and dead. It's not that his eyes don't see. It's not that his ears cannot hear. It's not that his hands cannot feel. The senses in themselves are biologically absolutely fine. Yet, it has never been the senses by themselves perceiving the reality. Our senses are like servants to a master, our awareness. They are slaves to this master. Whatever they capture, the master, the awareness, makes it real. When man is asleep, this awareness is dead. The senses, therefore, despite being biologically 100% fine, do not serve their purpose. It's like a man who is in coma. He can hear and yet not listen. He can look with a madman's gaze and yet not be able to see. He goes through the pain and yet he cannot feel it. This is the life condition of most around us. And in this situation, men are getting into relationships. It is in this situation that men are transacting business. It is in this situation that men are also going and preaching and telling others what to do and not to do. It is a very precarious situation. Men who are sleeping, who are blind, are leading many others who are sleeping, who are blind. One never knows what they are walking into. Is it a deep gorge? Is it the sea? Is it the desert? Nobody knows. Because the one who leads as well as the one who follows is in deep slumber, is in a state of imagining and knowing the imagination is real. And in this state of somnambulism, one is leading and many others are following. Such is the state of the business of life that we are living in. Such is the state of the safety, surety of human life. The biggest fear is not that people will go out in the road and will be killed in accident. The biggest fear is that in this state of reverie, in this state of dreaming and yet not knowing that one is dreaming, one is rapidly being led unto perishment. And more unfortunately, is leading others with whom he or she is related unto perishment. One may argue that this is a part of a larger design, so why should one bother about it? It's a part of universal will to lead some people unto perishment, so that those who are awake can have more space to grow and evolve. The argument about if one looks a little deeply and goes back to the universal will that created us, definitely man was not created to be perished. Man was created to go through the experience of life and figure out for himself or herself who he or she is. Humankind was created with the power of divinity bestowed into him. And the only way, and such is the design of this creation, that the only way one would get to know the enormity, the infiniteness of this power is by living it, is by experiencing it in the moment, in every breath one takes and leaves, in every experience of existence. And to be able to do this, the most important thing, the most important quality one would need to invoke is one's awareness, a gift that we were all born with, an awesome design that we were given to unfathom the mystery of who we are and who we are meant to be. So on the one hand lies the possibility of awakening and manifestation of divinity. On the other hand lies the precarious possibility of perishment. And this is where the second gift that we carry with us comes into force. The gift of the ability to make choices. The gift of seeking directions. The gift of values which help us in the moments of decision making to choose what is most appropriate for every individual as a unique being. And with these gifts, there is a third gift, the gift of guided grace. It is not that we were created and disconnected from the source of creation. every moment of our existence, the connection is still alive. Messages, guidance, and very, very deep-seated decisions are always getting communicated to us. Even in the state of our dreams, these messages may often be sent for us to hear and pay heed to. So while on the one hand there is this reality of the dreaming, sleeping man, on the other hand there is this awesome reality of the gifted man, the day he wakes up, the gifts are ready to help him move in the direction of becoming a man of action, a man who is out there to manifest divinity that he was born with.
If you observe yourself from the time you wake up till the time you go to sleep, and maybe even when you are sleeping in your dreams, you are in the realm of the past. The worries that you are preoccupied with the strategies, the plans that you are ruminating, the conversations that you engage in, everything, each and every thought, each and every language that you use, and whatever you do, is determined by the experiences that you have had in the past, and are stored as points of reference to help you know how to react, how to behave, how to think, how to speak in a given situation. The fallacy here is no two moments, and therefore no two experiences in the course of our lives are identical. The past tries to map the pattern of your experience to something which is close to what you have experienced in the past and gives you some kind of a recommendation, something like a best practice. For you to get back. No wonder how so often you find yourself mysteriously missing the point, because the piece of knowledge that you relied upon had a relationship to a point in time which is bygone, which is dead. Come to think of it, therefore, a very large chunk of our lives, be it in the waking hours or even in the sleep, we are spending with memories which are dead, which are frozen. It is as if mankind has chosen to make its home in the graveyard. Amidst the stories of the past, you have lived in this past for such a long time. You have lived amongst the dead and the buried for such a long time that it will be a contradiction of sorts to say that you have lived. It will be more appropriate to say that you have been dead. And if this realization dawns on you, shakes you up, and brings in you the urge come alive, you will first need to die unto the past. You will first need to willfully get out of your addiction, your toxic relationship with the past. And the only way to do that. Is to become intimate with that one thing, one gift that life has given us, which no matter where we are and where we choose to be, is always trying to remind us of the seed of aliveness that we all carry. And that one thing is our breath. So, in order to die unto the past, in order to break this toxic relationship with the past, one would need to build intimate bonds with one's breath. Yes, it is as simple as that. Watching it, experiencing it, loving it, owning it up. And suddenly, yes, it is very sudden, you will find yourself come alive. With all the energy, so much energy that you couldn't even imagine that you have. You will experience a stillness like that of the still water, which will reflect with utmost clarity your state of being and the existence in which you are. And the best thing that would happen is you will become a witness. You will suddenly find that you are not doing anything. You will find like the trees that bend in response to the breeze, things happening with you, around you. And when you will have nothing to do, you will very naturally become a witness. This is the journey of being reborn, and for that it is essential for you to die unto the past, not only once, that every moment, so that the very next moment you are born afresh.